Are you able to see the screen now? Hello?
No.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. Okay, let's start now. Today I'm planning to tell about property source, map struct, lombac, and interceptor. The four items we'll go to discuss today. Okay. First, we'll talk about a property source. What is a property source? Okay. See, if you want to load your custom property files, we can use property source. Using property source, we can handle the property files. Okay.
So screen not visible.
Screen not visible. Oh, okay. Okay. Sorry, guys. If you want to manipulate our property files, if you want to load the property files, if you want to manipulate the property files or YAML files, we need to use property source annotation. Using property source annotation, we can load the properties in easiest way. Okay. Here in this project, I am using a YAML file. Okay. I am not using a property file. If you want to load any property file, we need to use property source annotation. Then we need to mention that particular property file. Here I want to load system.yaml file. Okay. I want to load system.yaml file. At the same time, I want to map all the attribute in this Java class. Whatever attribute I have declared, right? Here emp code prefix, emp code type, cuss code. Don't think about what is this. It's just an attribute of system code configuration. In the system code configuration, we have this many attributes. I want to map whatever value available inside a system code. Okay. When you look at the system code, you can see system colon emp code prefix, emp code type, cuss code prefix, cuss code type. Like that, we have a lot of values here. I want to map these values. I want to map these all values respective my attributes. For example, this emp code prefix attribute contains the value of this value, emp value. This emp code type is a employee code, right? This employee code will contain inside an employee code type. Like that, each property value mapped in this attribute. Okay. For that, we need to declare one annotation called add property source. Inside annotation, the first argument, we need to mention value equal to class path, which property file or which YAML file you want to map. Okay, that I meant. I want to map system code.yaml. I have system code.yaml. That YAML file properties I want to map in this attribute. The second argument I am saying factory equal to YAML property source factory. When you're using property file, we don't have to mention this because automatically your Spring Boot application load the property file and map it to here. That will happen automatically. But if you are using YAML file, Spring Boot by default don't load the YAML files. Okay, we need to use this particular class. This is YAML property source factory. Inside this class, we need to override a method called create property source. This class implements with property source factory. Here we need to write some 3 lines of code to load that YAML property data to the in our corresponding Java class. This class is a configuration class. Why I'm saying it's a configuration class? Whenever you say add configuration, this class automatically will become configuration class. Whenever you start your Spring Boot application, load this YAML file and map all the data to in this particular attribute. Okay, this is the way of loading a property file and mapping a property value to the particular Java object. Wait, someone is coming. I hope you understand that whenever start the Spring Boot application, this system code configuration will contain all the value available in the system code.yaml file. I will going to show a small example. Now this particular, after starting the application, this particular class, right, we can use anywhere in your Spring Boot application. Here I have created a one class called test controller. Okay, this is a test controller. For testing purpose, I created this test controller. Now there is a method, endpoint called ping. Ping method is a publicly accessible method. To access this endpoint, we don't have to create a JWT. Okay, now I want to access those property data inside this method. For that, what you have to do, just to use this class inside test controller at autoword private, just to declare that. That's it. Once you declare that, you can access all the property data. Sorry. Now I want to just print system dot out of println. Now I want to print these two data. Which two data? These two data I want to print. Okay, in the property configuration file, what is that corresponding attribute? We need to check. We'll check that. Go here. This is the corresponding attribute, right? EMP prefix. Prefix plus. What is the file name? It's a system code configuration. System code configuration. Wait, someone is coming. System code configuration dot get EMP code prefix. Sorry. EMP code prefix. Then EMP code. Here I have to say EMP code type. Now I'm accessing EMP code prefix, EMP code type. This two method return this value. This value. One method return this value, one method return this value. Whenever you start the Spring Boot application, all the values, these all the values available inside a system code configuration because of this particular annotation. Okay. Now we'll go into test now. Now here I am accessing that system code configuration dot get EMP code prefix and then system code configuration dot get EMP code type. Let's restart the server now. Server is starting. Yeah, server is started now. Now I'm going to call this particular ping method. Okay. For that, I need to access this path. Go to this path. HTTP colon localhost. Localhost 9091 slash, what is that ping, right? It's a ping. Server is running. It's printing the statement, server is running, whatever statement I'm returning, that printing. This I'm doing printing system dot out of print, that is console. I'm printing in console, right? See a console, you can see here. This line, EMP prefix, printing EMP, EMP code, printing employee code. So it's coming from where? It's coming from system code.yaml file. Okay. This is the where to map the property attribute to the particular Java class. Okay, using property source, we can very effectively map the property files value to the your Java object. Okay, I hope this you understand. Any questions? If you are using property files, dot properties files, you don't have to pass this second parameter. If you are using if you are using dot YAML files, you have to use this one.
So for properties file, that second parameter does it is not required, and like one configuration class is required and one system property, right?
Correct. Yeah. One more thing I forgot to tell. When you look at your configuration property dot system, I'm saying configuration property dot system. That meaning, if any data, any property value start with system, that is prefix with system. I want to load only that property. I'm doing the same here. Okay. When you look at the system code.yaml file, I'm starting with system. System colon. Under I have all the things. I want to load only this set of data. That is the meaning of this particular annotation. I want to load some data from the system code.yaml file. That data prefixed with system. Only that data load under affine to this attribute. Okay. The next one is map struct. Next one is a map struct. How to configure map struct? We'll see. We'll go into this one small demo. I don't want to show the example in existing code that will confuse you. I'll go into create a one small code. Through that, I will show the demo. Okay. Here I'm going to create a one class called color info. Okay, color info. I don't want, so I'll add it. You can use it. I will update this code. Okay. Private color name. String color name, private string color ID. Okay, I'm going to keep this first. Okay, color ID. I'll going to keep it as a int. Okay, color ID. Then I don't want to create a getter and a setter. Part of this I'll explain you long back also. What I want to explain long back also, right? Part of this I'll explain long back also. See, generally, if you create any attributes, right, we will going to generate a setter and a getter. Okay. But if you're using Lombak library, we don't have to create getter and a setter manually. Okay. That getter setter creation taken care by our Lombak library. Okay. The Lombak library provides annotation called getter and a setter. This annotation will take care of creating a getter setter method for this particular two attributes. The same thing I'm using for all the entity object and a dative object. Okay. Now I created a dative object. Now I'm going to copy this and paste it to my entity package. I'm changing it to color entity, something like that. Okay. Entity. Okay. I'll change it to just a color. And the same thing, the same attribute I want to use here. Okay, the same attribute I want to use here. The intention of our work is I want to migrate whatever value available here. I want to migrate that value to my color object. For that, I need to use MapStruct. Now, for this object, we need to create one interface. Through interface, we need to tell copy this object to that object. Okay. Next step is we need to create one interface. the mapper class, there is a mapper package. Instead of mapper package, map package, I have an implement IMPL package, then interfaces inside the mapper package. Okay, I'm going to copy one class here. Okay, I don't want to create a newly and paste. Just I'm going to changing color mapper. Color mapper. Okay. The color mapper, the first, it's an interface. Okay, it's not a class, it's an interface. Public interface color mapper. Here I'm saying at mapper implementation package should be in mapper.iml. That is whatever implementation call, whatever implementation class for these two methods, that implementation class must be in IMPL package. That is the meaning of this particular line. I want to move implementation of these interface classes under IMPL package. That is the meaning of this particular line. Okay, now color mapper instance equal to mapper.getMapper. We have to pass this color mapper object. That meaning you are creating an instance of the particular color mapper. Then we need to tell from which object you want to convert. I want to convert color info to color. This is a name, just a naming convention. I am following this word color info to color. I want to change color. I want to convert color info to color. So I am passing a color info here. Color info, then color info. I am passing color info object. That color info object convert as a color object. Okay, then and inner it inverse configuration. That is, I want to change opposite way now. Different types of offer. Then I want to convert offer to I want to convert, what is this here? Color. Color to this method convert color to color info. Okay, just two interface we have to define. Okay, one is I am doing here, I want to change color info to color. Another one is color to color info. That's it. That is the configuration. We have completed the configuration of converting one object to another object. These steps we have to follow for each and every object. Okay. Then we need to clean and install. When you say that, what's happening? I stop the server, then install. When you build this application, what will happen? Your MapStruct framework check this interface. For this interface, it automatically create an implementation class. We don't have to write an implementation class. It will automatically create the implementation class and then copy that implementation class inside a target folder. I will tell you the location of the target folder. Still it's building. Still it's building. Yeah, build is successful. Go to target location, target folder. There is a one folder called generated source. Instead of generated source, you can see, since we have mentioned a mapper.impl, it's created mapper.impl package. Under that package, you can see one class called, one new class called color mapper impl. It's created. It's do all the implementation, how to convert color info to color, how to convert color to color info. That implementation taken care by this particular implementation class. Okay, just to copy this class. And paste it to your IMPL package. I'm keeping all the implementation class here. Okay, that is a temporary location, so I want to keep it here. I'm going to paste it here. Now I created a one mapping implementation for color object through the map struct. I have not done any coding. Okay, just I return a one interface. In the interface, I mentioned how to convert color to color info or the color info to color. That's it. Now I can use this class anywhere you want in your application. For testing purpose, I'll go to the same test controller. The purpose of color mapper is only for demo purpose. Don't have any use of color mapper. I am showing for your demo purpose to easy understanding about the map struct. Okay. Now, 1 minute. Well, I look at some service class. We need to call like this. The test controller, I'm going to say here I'm converting category info to category. Now we have to convert color info to color info to, we have to convert a color, right? So I'm going to say color. Then here we need to pass not a category mapper, it's a color mapper dot instance. It is coming from the interface color in dot instance. Color info to color. Then we need to pass color info. Actually, this color info coming from the request body. As of now, I don't want to do that. Just I'm going to say color info equal to new color info dot set color ID 100. Color info dot set color name blue. Now this object having a two value called 100 and blue. That object is passing color info dot color. This will going to convert color info to my color object. Okay. Then here I want to print that value. println color data. Then I can even say system dot out dot println color ID color dot get ID get color ID color dot out dot println color name color dot color name. Okay, now this particular method convert, this particular method will implement it where? Whatever implementation class we have generated. Our map struct framework generated one implementation class, right? In that method, you can see this color info to color. See here, color to color info, then color info to color. Okay, this method get called. that method get call and convert color info to color object. That color object I am printing here. Okay. Now we'll going to restart the server. Server is starting now. Server is started now. Okay. Now the same endpoint, right? The ping endpoint we need to call. It's called now. See here. Color data. It's coming. Color ID 100. It's coming from where? It's coming from color object. Actually, I have set that data color info. Now the data copied to color. That data here printing here. Through this way, we need to do for all the DTO object as well as the entity object. These are the steps we need to follow to convert one object to another object in MapStruct framework. Apart from this, we need to do one more thing is we need to add the artifact. See, we need to add the MapStruct artifact. Then we need to add a plugin. When you look at here, there is a plugin section. Inside a plugin section, you can see inside the annotation processor path, inside that annotation tag, sorry, inside that tag, we need to add this section. Okay. Then only it will work, otherwise it will not work. This is very, very important. I hope how easy in MapStruct, I think you understand how to work with the MapStruct now. It's very easy, right? We don't have
to write. Can you come again?
Sorry?
Can you come again with this like pom.xml?
Yeah. We need to add this and we need to add instead of plugin this section we need to add. If you're using MapStruct, if you're using Lombak, we need to add this also. For this for Lombak. Okay. We'll notice that here, right? In the color object, I'm not creating any setter getter method, but I'm accessing get color name. That is because of Lombak label. Okay. So we'll go through this MapStruct framework. We can avoid a lot of boilerplate code. We don't have to write manually anything to convert one object to another object. Very similarly, in the case of Lombak also. Lombak, we don't have to generate setter getter and we don't have to generate a constructor. Everything taken care by Lombak library. We don't have to write those boilerplate code. We can keep our code very neat through this framework. Anything? Any questions?
No.
Okay. Then
one question.
Yeah.
When we use Lombak, the plugin is automatically added, but that is not in the case of MapStruct, yeah?
MapStruct automatically added, meaning MapStruct also is automatically added. We're not doing anything.
No. I'm asking when we added the Lombak dependency, the plugin for the Lombak is automatically added in the
plugin. No. We have to add.
Okay. Thank you.
See, one more thing, when you add a Lombak, right, there is a some installation step. Okay, this getter setter method, it's not showing anything. It's not whenever I access this particular get color ID, get color name, I don't have any compilation error because of Lambac library magic. Okay, but that is will not never happen. That is never happen after adding the pom.xml, after adding this artifact inside a pom.xml. We have to follow some configuration in your IDE. In the case of Eclipse, STS, and IntelliJ, we need to follow some configuration. Through that only we can avoid the compilation error. Otherwise, we will get the compilation error. For that, I have added the video. For one video added, I have shared already those videos, right? There is one video I will show how to fix that issue in the IntelliJ as well as Eclipse and STS. Eclipse, I showed only Eclipse. Whatever steps we need to follow on Eclipse, the same step exactly we need to follow STS also. Okay. Okay, then we'll see now FlywayDB. FlywayDB, there is another framework called FlywayDB. What is the purpose of FlywayDB? Using FlywayDB, we can manage our database script, our DB script, our database tables, we can manage very perfectly. We can manage our database change history. We can manage. Okay, those things we can manage. Also, we can, if you want to do any migration, I want to load some data to the table. For that purpose, you can go with FlywayDB frame, FlywayDB. Okay. If you want to integrate FlywayDB, you need to add this artifact. Okay, you need to add this artifact. Then we need to create a one folder called DB. Under that folder, we need to get a migration. DB.migration. Inside that migration folder, we need to keep all the SQLs. We need to keep all the SQLs. Okay. See here, I have maintaining multiple version of SQLs. There is a 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, up to 1.6 I have. Okay. This is the initial tables. When I start this project, at that time I have designed some tables. That table structure I have posted here. Then this particular SQL load, whenever start the server, this particular SQL load and create the table. After creating all the table from this file, what will happen? There is a one table called Flyway Schema History. Flyway Schema History. Whatever query executed successfully, those queries added here. Those queries added here. I'll go to remove this. This is not right. Okay. See here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There is a 6th version of SQL already loaded and available in the database. Okay. So the Flyway schema history, maintaining that history here. This schema, this particular table is created by Flyway framework. This table not created by me, it's created by Flyway framework. After successful integration, Flyway framework automatically create this table, then maintain all the SQL history. So far I have done 6 different SQL, each SQL having some SQL script. That SQL script executed in our database. After executed, that SQL file name maintained here, that history maintained here. Okay, now next I want to create one more table. What you have to do for that? We need to create one more SQL file. Okay. Now I'll copy this. Okay, I'll copy this. Then this is the naming convention we need to follow. V is a default naming convention, followed by we have to tell version number. That version number always start with 1. Then we can pass whatever version. Apart from that, you can pass whatever version number you want to maintain. Now I want to maintain v1.1.6, then next version is a 7. Then we have to say 2 underscore, that is a separator. 2 underscore is a separator. After that separator, you can give any name. You can give any script name. Now I want to create a one test table. For that, I'm going to say test underscore create. This can be anything, but here you have to follow the naming convention. First you have to follow B, then version number, then .1.1.7. This part anything. Okay, this is a must. V1 is a must, then V1, V2, V3, like that we have to go. Since I completed up to 1.6, I want to create v1.1.7, then underscore underscore is a separator. After that, we need to mention any SQL script name. I'm going to create this. I don't want to add this in repository. Okay, cancel it. I'll copy this file table, entire table, then paste it here. I name it as a test. I'll remove everything. I'll get only two columns, okay? Make it simple for understanding purpose. I'm keeping only first name and the last name. Okay, well, I want to create one more table. Whenever start the server, I want to create one more table. What will happen when you start the server, where FlyByDB check this particular table. Only here we have only 6 version of files. The 7th version is not available. So it think that this is a new file. We need to execute. It understand automatically. So it will keep the take this SQL script and execute and create that table in a database. Now we'll go and restart the server. Server is started now. When you look at this particular flyway schema history table, there is a new entry is coming. 7. Test create that a file name, that particular file name. When you look at the table here, you can don't see any table right here. Test table. I'll go into refresh. See a test table is coming. First name, last name. First name, last name. Okay. This is the way to maintain the database history, our DB change history. Through Flyway, we can effectively change the DB histories. Okay, whatever change we have done from the beginning, that history we can maintain. Also, we can load some default data. When you look at the version 1.2, I am doing insert operation. Whenever you set up the application, whenever set up the billing system, very first time, all SQL loaded, the respective, each SQL, there is some SQL script, right? That SQL script execute and populated in your database. If it is SQL query, if it is insert query, it will populate the table. If it is a definition, it will create that table in your database. Okay. Understand? About this flyway?
Yeah, so that db.migration, right? So that also like it's predefined, like we have to follow.
Exactly, it's a predefined, yeah. It's a predefined.
Okay, so under the resource folder, the db migration, db.migration or db migration?
It's a folder, it's dot... I think. It's a folder, let's see.
So this folder name should match, right?
Yeah, folder must be matched.
Okay.
So here DB is a folder, under that there is a migration. Okay.
And this naming convention V1, version 1, after that we can follow anything, right?
Yeah, correct. I will going to show one example here. Flyway. I'm going to share this site. Okay, here they'll clearly mention what is the naming convention, everything. Okay, see here. Also, we can customize the name, everything. We can do that. Where is that file is coming here? There will be a one article. Yeah, see here. They mentioned example V1, something we can, V1 is a mandatory. Okay, then it starts with 1. I'll share this in your WhatsApp group. I hope to understand the flyway and property source, then what I long back, then map start. Okay, fourth thing we covered today. Now the final one is interceptor. Okay, it's one of the Spring Boot feature. Interceptor is one of the Spring Boot feature. You can see here there is a request logging interceptor. What is the purpose of interceptor? Before handling the request, whenever client requesting something, I want to get some information about the client. Who is that client? Is a valid client, or I want to retrieve some IP address, something I want to do before going into the request. And after completion of request, I want to do something. After completion of request, I want to do something. After totally completion of request, I want to do something. I will tell difference. What is after completion of, after total completion of. Okay. For in these three cases, I want to do some operation in my application. Okay. In such a case, we can use interceptor. We can use interceptor. Okay. That interceptor class must be a component class. Okay. Public class. Request logging interceptor, that class must implemented with handler interceptor. Okay, this class we have to override three different methods. One is pre-handle, another one is post-handle, another one is after completion. These are three different callback method is a invoke different cases. This is a callback method. It will automatically call. Okay, whenever send a request, that time pre-handle will call. That time if you want to do any operation, that respective code, the respective program you have to do inside this method. Then post-handle, after generating a response, I want to do something, we can use post-handle. Then after completion, looks like both are same, right? But it's not exactly same. For example, let's take one controller class, test controller. It will take this test controller. Whenever sender requests, that time pre-handle will call. Now request is coming. We are processing this. Then we are sending the response. After sending response completed, after the successful response generator, that time post handle will execute. Now client got the response. Now UA, whatever response got from the server, now UA generating some user interface, rendering the UA, right? That time after completion will execute. Okay, this is after generating a response, after completion of the response. This is after rendering the UI. That time after completion will get executed. So we have a three scenarios. Here I handled the two scenarios, pre-handle and the post-handle. I wanted to know what is the request and the response time. Whenever send a request, based on the request, my server return some response, right? I want to calculate how long that request response processing time is taking. How long it's taking? That time I want to calculate that logic available here. As well as I want to print current client IP address. The two things I am doing here. This get client IP address, return the current IP address. That IP address I am printing here. That's it. Okay, that is there are some logic I am doing. Just to go out and check the code. It's simple only. Okay. Get client IP address, return a IP address. That IP address I am printing here. Then pre-handle nothing but whenever send a request, that time it will execute, right? Before sending request, that time I am taking current time millis. That current time I am taking whenever send a request, that time I am taking a current date and time. Okay, that start time, current time millis, that value assigned to start time. Then I am setting this value in request.set attribute. then key is a start time, then value is a what is the time here. I'm setting it. Now after completion of the request, after generating a response, this method get execute, right? At the time, what I am doing, whatever value I am setting here, that value I am taking, that is request start time I am taking here. Then here I am taking current time. At the time of generating a response, after generating a response, whatever current time, the current time coming here. Okay, now I am subtracting that the final time will come here. That is the request time, request response processing time I am printing here. Okay, this kind of manipulation we can use for our interceptor class. Okay, if you want to implement this interceptor, the as I mentioned, we have to implement handle interceptor. Then we need to register this class in our Spring Boot application. Then only it will work. How to register that? The interceptor config. I created one configuration class called interceptor config. Interceptor config. That interceptor config implements with web MVC configurer. Web MVC configurer, that is a mandatory. We have to implement this. Okay. Then whatever interceptor class you have created, that class we have to auto-wire here. We have to create an instance of that particular interceptor class through auto-wire. Then there is one override method called add interceptor. Using add interceptor, we can add our interceptor class. There is one parameter called interceptor registry. Through that object I am adding register.addInterceptor, whatever interceptor class you want to add. That's it. You are registered your interceptor in your Spring Boot application. This class will invoke whenever request is coming, pre-handle invoke, whenever response is completed, this will execute. After completion of request, after completion of response, this will go into execute. That is whenever render, UI start rendering, that time after completion will execute. Okay. This is the way of implementing an interceptor in our Spring Boot application. Okay. Any questions? Today we have seen, I think property source, map track, Lombak, Flyway DB, and interceptor. Any doubts you can ask me now. Today is a final class. Okay. I will go into commit whatever I did. I will copy that code. Okay. I will copy that code in the Google Drive. Committed after completion of the session, I will go into copy this updated code. You can check that MapStrack example, then what is that Flyway DB examples, those things. One more thing, sorry, I don't want to keep this this one. This right, what is that? This is, I don't want to keep, this is not added, this is never committed, this is not added to the repo, it's not committed. Okay, no problem. Yeah, I'll go and take 5 minutes now. Now we have completed. Hopefully it's the 5-day session. You enjoyed some information. You got it, right? At least some information. I think the people who don't know Spring Boot proper, Spring Boot, definitely those people get confused. But they have to learn. Okay, but once you learn Spring Boot properly, if you go back and check that our billing application, definitely you understand. Okay. Okay, then coming 28th, right? Coming 20th, I'll go to start the Spring Boot microservices Docker class. Interested people can join. Okay, interested people can join. I'll going to share that WhatsApp link. The people who wanted to join, you can. 1 minute, where is that things? Not this month, sorry. I'll copy this invitation link. Okay, copy this invitation link, not this one here. Yeah. Where is that? This one. I copy this invitation link and put it to in this WhatsApp group. If you want to learn, join this group. Okay. Also, I encourage a lot of people. The other day I discussed, right, how many people want to join. So many people are saying that they have financial problem, they cannot pay, something like that they are saying. I understand your problems. Okay. I think due to corona pandemic situation, people not able to spend, I think. Okay. I come up with some solution. I'm able to reduce the cost. I don't want to take 5,000 rupees. I told 5,000 rupees, right? I don't want to take 5,000. You can pay only 3,000. That's fine. That's fine for me. Okay. All I want to do, I want to provide a quality service to you people. Okay. I'll keep my fee as the 3,000. Interested people, join this WhatsApp group. I'm planning to start this session January 28th. January 20. Okay, January 20, I plan to start because next week here is a festival days, next whole week. So, so many people don't want to join, okay, during that period. So that I keep that session started January 20. Interested people, please join to this group, okay? Any questions? Apart from this session, do you want to talk anything? How is my session for 5 days? Do you feel good or bad? Anything you can tell. I want to know.
I want to say something. First, I want to thank you for the great sessions.
Okay.
Especially for the best practices and the new frameworks I have learned from these 5 sessions until now. I want to say it's appreciated efforts and thanks for this opportunity.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Muhammad.
Me too. I have learned some new technologies, technical stuffs from this presentation. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Nimalan. Thank you very much.
Great. It was really a quick refresh of a lot of concepts. You were very patient in all the questions we asked.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Arvind.
So first of all, so thank you for giving the source code, sharing the source code. So it's a beautiful, I think. If someone wants to learn a lot, I think that source code will really help once he starts debugging and see, starts seeing the thing. It will help a lot to understand the code because I think it will help in the way if a person joins the company and if he's given the source code, right?
Yeah.
So the very first thing, we need to deploy and we need to understand the code by ourselves after the KT session. So I think this is the best project we can do it in our home itself. Yeah. Get some knowledge.
Thank you, guys. Okay, shall we wind up now?
Yeah.
Okay. If you have any questions in the future, if you try to deploy anything, try to deploy Blink system in your local machine, if you're stuck, please let me know. I will respond. Okay, no problem. Thank you, Vivek. Bye. Thank you, everybody. Bye.